This week on the Men at the Movies podcast, we wrap up our summer blockbuster series with Saving Private Ryan. We live in a world at war, but our enemy isn't who you think it is. Going through battle requires fluid leadership and reveals a bond of brotherhood. And in the brutality of the fight, we must choose every day to pursue compassion, guard our hearts, and hold on to our humanity. Join us as we discover our stories in this movie.
The movies and stories we love are gateways to see ourselves and God in new ways.
Every great story borrows its power from a larger story. The story that's written on our hearts and woven into the fabric of our very being.
Hello and welcome to the Men at the Movies podcast. My name is Paul McDonald, and joining me via the Zoom machine is Britt Mooney. Hey, man, how you doing today?
I am doing pretty well. I'm pretty happy. Finished a rough draft of a book today, so woohoo! I'm in celebration mode, and I'll probably cry during this podcast recording at some point. Not because I'm sad, just because of the subject matter, but yeah, I'm doing pretty well. How are you?
Doing well. Been struggling. Our internet went out today, so we are connected via my phone's hotspot, which hasn't always proved to be the most reliable source of interwebs. So here today, I think we're wrapping up our summer blockbuster series with Saving Private Ryan. Came out, 1998, which is 23 years ago. Wow. So we've actually got one that's not on like one of the big zero anniversaries. The other one seemed to have been like 20, 40.
Oh, sure. Yeah.
So Britt, why did we pick Saving Private Ryan as one of our blockbusters?
We haven't done a war movie that I can think of. I don't know that we've really done a war movie, and I really get a lot out of war movies. God shows me a lot with war movies. Band of Brothers, Saving Private Ryan, We Were Soldiers. I mean, there's a lot of war movies that I can point to and talk about, just some lessons, spiritual lessons that God has shown me. And we are in a war, and I think this is one of the best war movies of all time, if not the best. I mean, I can't, there might be some that are as good, but you can't find a better war movie. It's Spielberg. It's some amazing writing. Tom Hanks, amazing. The casting, even some of the minor characters, are amazing character actors. And Sam Malone from Cheers was in it. Nathan Fillion from Firefly.
I saw him.
I'm like, oh my gosh, I didn't realize he was in it. I mean, just so many great actors. Bryan Cranston. So it's got some, it's just a really well made movie, but I think the themes, there's so many great themes that are going on in this that we can learn from. And when I first saw it, it had such a big impact on me. No one wanted to go see it with me because people who may not have been around or remember, but when the movie came out, there was this big thing about how rough the first scene and yeah, violent, how violent it was when they talked about D-Day. And by the way, they interviewed men who had been at D-Day on one of the beaches, Omaha or whatever. And they said, oh no, it was still worse than what you showed. I mean, like, it was so bad. I mean, it was so, but it's very violent opening scene, opening sort of sequence of D-Day. So a lot of people didn't want to go see it with me. And I was a history major. I wanted to go see it, but I just wept like a baby at the end. It was in the afternoon and I was like four people in the theater. It just really had an impact on me. And I was a young man, and just the themes in it really, really touched me. So I think we're going to have a great time today. It's going to be a great message.
And as we're trying to do, we're not going to go step by step chronologically through this movie. I mean, this movie is almost 3 hours long. That would take us forever. So we're just going to sort of focus on the themes and pull up some of the clips. I'm going to go over the themes and then we'll talk about them one at a time. We've got the idea of brotherhood in the trenches and just the relationship that happens between
men and women, honestly, in battle. You've got the leadership of Captain Miller, which both with his failures and his successes and his eventual redemption, and then sort of the end of, and I think that I wrote down something about that every man wonders, am I a good man? Was it worth it? And so we'll hit all of those. So we get into this and they go through, and like you said, that scene is just brutal. And there's a lot of people that have been in, not just obviously not just World War II, but in war, in battle, that have, that scene has triggered their PTSD. Oh, yeah. Because when you go through something, when you experience that level of warfare together, the guys who sort of survive and make it through, they become not just, I mean, brothers is sort of a weak word for some of it. We were talking, and right, the camaraderie and the, intimacy without any sexual overtones, but the intimacy between these guys, you know, they're like blowing each other kisses. And we both love the scene where they like, hey, you got any, you have another piece of gum? And he basically bites it in half and gives him the other piece of it. And they don't even think about it. And yeah, so that the battle kind of creates that bond of brotherhood.
Here's what battle does. Battle makes us realize what's most important and what not to focus on. And just, we are in a war. I mean,
yeah,
I've said it before, and I'll keep saying it. And my mentor said it, and he probably wasn't the first one, but maybe he was. But, you know, a lot of us feel like Christianity is an invitation to a cruise ship, especially yeah, in Western American Christianity. But Christianity is, you're being recruited on a battleship. I mean, this is not, and we're surprised when we get on what we think is a cruise ship, and all of a sudden we're told to swab the decks, and here's how you load the big guns, and people start dying around us, and it starts, and war is hell. That's the reality. That seeing the unseen, as full of joy and amazement as it is, it's also seeing the unseen is throwing us into battle like they were thrown into the chaos and battle of D-Day. Right. And like he keeps saying, like he says, like they just wanted to stay there. They're like, I don't want to move. Like they're
this gonna, is the
they,
only thing between you know, me and the Almighty.
and he says, if we stay here, we die. Like yep, you have to, like the only choice is to move forward. But it's not that we create the battle. The battle is already going on. Just seeing the unseen through faith means that we are aware of the battle. We are aware now of the unseen battle. And so what battles do is we stop arguing about the color of the carpet in the church, right? We stop arguing about crap, whether or not you believe it's once saved, always saved, and I believe you can lose your salvation. And we stop arguing about stuff like that. It becomes, is it Jesus? Do you believe in Jesus? Do you right, believe in saving and preaching? Do you believe in what's real and what matters? And you start giving grace to each other. And so that theme throughout the movie is so well done. I mean, all the themes are well done because it's Spielberg, but that is such an important part of this movie, is that camaraderie that we can have. But I think so much of us don't really see the battle, or we're not told about the battle, or we don't approach it that way. And so we're easily divided by the enemy that way.
That was something I wrote down about that the scene of Normandy. It was a picture of the spiritual reality that we live in. That it's not Amen. It's not a kingdom of peace. It's at least not yet. It's kingdom warfare. And the other piece, yeah, and it bothers me when I see this, is we lose sight of who our enemy is.
Amen.
Because the enemy is not people who disagree with us. Our enemy is not the ones who might be immoral according to our religious standards. That's what Paul said. Our battle is not against flesh and blood. If you're a That's Republican, right. it's not against the Democrats. If you're a liberal, it's not against the conservatives. If you're for gun control, it's not for those against gun control. You know, it's not against the people. It's against the spiritual forces of this world. And they come to steal, kill, and destroy. Those are not, you know, devour. It's not, hey, it's not a pickpocket. It's we want to demolish your life. And that the core of that is our heart. And the battle is for our hearts. And it is that fierce. And man, Britt, as a pastor and me with my work with men's groups and stuff, I've both seen it in other guys and I've experienced it.
Yeah.
And it's hard. I think it's very easy to package Jesus as, look what Jesus can do for you. Look why Jesus is better. And it's the good stuff without the reality of the world that you're stepping into.
Well, we have been sold this and we have adopted it. I mean, not we, you and me, and but because we are part of the church, we can help take responsibility. Mm-hmm. But in this sense, we have adopted this therapeutic idea of God's love. If God loved me, then nothing bad would ever happen to me.
Right.
And I've literally had these conversations with people who were once believers and then became atheists. And their reasoning is, this bad thing happened to me. I was betrayed. Someone did this. Someone did that. And this happened to me. I lost my marriage. I'm like, legitimately bad stuff. Right. I'm not saying they're not bad things. But if you don't see your walk with Christ, that you're in a battle and there will be casualties in this. And what I've said to this one individual, I said, you know, the Bible, like, cause I was confused. I was like, you know, the Bible really well. When does Jesus ever promise that everything will work out like you want it to, and you won't have problems? In fact, he literally promises that you will, in this world, you will have trouble. Like, this is going, things will happen and you will want to lose. Like, we are told, don't lose heart. We're told that because we're going to want to lose heart. Like, I mean, like we're not told those things just to make us feel better. And Jesus said, look, I'm going to tell you what's going to happen before they happen. So you won't quit. I'm going to be given up for dead. And remember, Peter says, no, that'll never happen to you. And he says, get behind me, Satan. This idea that we're not going to have to go through a battle, that we're not going to have to carry our cross, that it's not going, that's just all going to be rainbows and butterflies and great worship songs and 3 points and I feel better. Like, if we think that's Christianity, you're not reading the Bible the way it's written. I mean, it's just not, it's just the way it is. And so I love that about this movie, that war is hell on earth. War, you're literally aware now that it's, and when you become a Christian, I'm sorry, you become a target more than, and not only are you aware of it more, you're more of a target.
Well, that's what it says in Revelation, that the dragon, Satan, goes off to wage war on the offspring of Jesus, those who believe in Jesus and hold on to his word. That's us.
That's right. That's right. And what I love about Miller in this beginning is he has moments where he doesn't know what to do. He right. has a moment where he's dazed and he's confused and he doesn't, like, that's normal. Like, that doesn't mean
you're gonna
you don't
get
believe
rocked.
That you're going to get rocked, right? Like we were dealing with Top Gun, right? Where the mentor says, it would have shook me too. What happened to you?
Yeah.
Would have shook me. You know, I mean, like, we have to be honest that it's going, not going to be fun all the time. And we have to be honest about the pain. But what he ends up doing in order to save others, yeah. That's the important part of that movie, is he's like, we have to find a way off of this beach. If we stay here, we're just going to get, we're in the open. We're going to get cut down. They've got mortars and 88s and machine guns. They've got everything pinned us, you know, to us right here. We got to get off this beach. And so he pioneers a way off the beach.
Yeah.
Like, he becomes a pioneer. And even though he looks around, he goes, who's in charge? You are, sir. Like he doesn't always know what to do, but he knows he's got to move forward. And I love that, because it's what we have to come to. And of course, along the way, you know, he kind of forms a bond with these guys. But anyway, so it's a great first scene. It's a tough first scene because it's definitely not like fun. It's action, but it's not the kind of action that, you know, you like to watch. I mean, it's pretty rough.
It's hard to watch.
It's hard to watch. That's why I like that sort of beginning part, because it establishes Miller's character as a leader willing to do what is tough, but right for everyone. Because like you said, he was able to find a way off the beach, not just to win the battle, but to save people. I thought that was great.
While it is hard to watch, it's a picture of both inspiring bravery and devastating loss. Mm. And it appears completely random, much like the battle we face every day. And there's bravery, and there's bravery, and sometimes bravery is just moving forward. Because like that kid said, it feels better to hide behind that little iron thing. Right. And it's like, no, you will eventually die if you stay here. You have to keep moving.
Yeah.
And the brave part is, as the story goes and we meet Upham, and he becomes sort of the foil, because he's writing a book, right, about the brotherhood of war. And he appears to know nothing about what being a brother means in the battlefield. Mm-hmm.
For Corporal Upham.
Yes, sir.
Timothy E.
I'm Upham, sir.
I understand you speak French and German.
Yes, sir.
How's your accent?
It's just a slight one in French, but my German's clean, has a touch of Bavarian, sir.
Very good. You've been reassigned to me. Grab your gear.
I'm going to a place called Neuville.
Yes.
When was this updated?
Updated as of 08, 30 hours morning.
Yes, sir.
This is the 12th SS Panzer. Sir. These are the two axes of advance south.
Sir, there are Germans.
There are artillery in here,
I understand,
sir.
Corporal. Yes,
There are a lot of Germans in the Ville.
You have a problem with that, Corporal?
No, sir. Just if you consider, I've never been in combat, sir. I make maps and I translate, and that's...
I need someone who speaks French and German.
Yes, sir.
My two guys were killed.
Yes, sir. It's just that I haven't held a weapon since basic training, sir.
Did you fire the weapon in basic training?
Yes, sir.
Well, then get your gear.
Yes, sir.
It's yours.
Sir, may I bring... Bring my typewriter, sir. Thank you very much.
Is that a souvenir?
No, sir.
Take your time, Corporal. You should look on the bright side of things, Corporal.
Yes.
For one thing, you don't need to carry those. You'll need that.
Need this.
Yes. That is his helmet. He will need that.
just a couple things. So here's what the enemy tries to do. And the enemy's trying to surround us with chaos. And that's what we see on the beach, right? That's what we see on the beach at Normandy. It's chaos. It's absolute chaos. And people are confused and they're afraid. And it causes fear. And just stop there and just let me pound away at you with bullets and guns, right? But Miller's leadership is to organize. You get this, right? So he's trying to bring order to that chaos somehow. And that's how he's able to pioneer. And we see that again at the end, at the bridge, before they're attacked. And, you know, when Ryan decides he's going to stay, and we'll play that clip later, but Miller organizes, he gives people roles. He gives people purpose. Like, people love this. Like, and this is what the kingdom does. This is what the kingdom does. Okay. Some are apostles, some are prophets, some are, you have this gift. You have this gift. Like boom, 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 boom. You have a place, you have a purpose, right? So that's his leadership, is bringing a purposeful order to combat the chaos that's about to happen. But then the whole thing with Upham, as you were playing that, I'm sitting here thinking, this is what people experience coming out of seminary. This is what people experience coming out of seminary. I've never actually been in a battle. I've never actually been on the ground. Well, did you fire your weapon? Well, I had a class on it. Right. Yeah. I mean, like this is what we get with a lot of modern day Christians and leaders and pastors, is that they haven't actually, they've learned a lot in school and they can repeat a lot and they can talk to you about doctrine and theology. But they don't know what they, can I bring my typewriter? Like, dude, you're going into a battle. Here's your pencil. Like, you need the helmet. You know what I mean? Like, and Paul tries to tell us what we need, you know, the helmet. And
you don't need all this baggage.
You don't need all the baggage, man. You don't and until you've been through it. And a lot of pastors quit because they start getting attacked and they haven't learned what's necessary. That it's not that, like, he was going to leave the helmet and take the typewriter. Like, and again, but it's like, if we don't know, battles teach us what's important, what we need. And Miller knew what he was going to need. And we have to pay attention to that stuff.
Well, it's like my brother says, he was a great father, knew everything about parenting and fatherhood until kids came along. He's like, and I've heard that before, is if I was going to write a parenting book, I should have done it before I had kids.
Who was it? The boxer?
Mike Tyson.
Mike Tyson. His quote is one of the best quotes. You know, everyone's got
everybody has a plan till you get punched in the mouth.
It's true.
So they go and they get punched in the mouth.
Yep.
A little bit. They go and, you know, they're in this village and somebody does something stupid. Vin Diesel gets shot before he goes on to, he becomes a superhero in Fast and Furious. But then it leads to this conversation about worth. What is a man worth? Especially because they're on this mission to save one guy. They've got eight guys, now seven, because Vin Diesel's dead. And he's got this struggle. And they have this conversation in this church with his sergeant, who's, you know, if you're familiar with the military, like, you've got Captain Miller, who's in charge, but your sergeant is your right-hand man.
Yeah.
He's your consigliere. He's the guy who gets stuff done. Oh, by the way, these clips are going to be unedited. So if you haven't, if you've got kids, you're going to want to, you know, turn this off until you have time to watch it. This is going to get one of those ratings to on for the podcast.
The just so,
yeah. Just so you know, but so they're talking about how he deals with the losses of his men.
You see, when you end up killing one of your men, you see, you tell yourself, it happened so you could save the lives of two or three or 10 others, you know, maybe 100 others. Do you know how many men I've lost under my command?
How many?
94. But that means I've saved the lives of 10 times that many, doesn't it? Maybe even 20, right? 20 times as many. And that's how simple it is. That's how you rationalize making the choice between the mission and the men.
Except this time the mission is man.
This Ryan better be worth it. He'd better go home, cure some disease, or invent a longer-lasting light bulb or something. The truth is, I wouldn't trade 10 Ryans for one Vecchio or one Caparzo.
And Mike says, amen, after that.
Yeah.
Because those are the men that they had been in battles with. Those are the men that they had been intimate with in the sense of their brotherhood. You know, something I wrote down is that they're basically in the middle of war. They're going on a mission of compassion.
Yeah.
Right. I mean, that's the whole conversation with the Marshall, whatever, Chief General, whoever. George C. Marshall. Where he quotes from Abraham Lincoln and he's like, no, we got to go do this. Like, this is important. This is important, not just because it's important to Ryan and not just because it's important to his mother. It's important to who we are as human beings that we do this. Like, this is important that in the midst of this horrible, awful war, we don't take life lightly. And he doesn't say all that, but that's the implication, right? And so, but the men in the middle of this mission are having, they're struggling with that. They're struggling with, why does he get compassion? Where was compassion for Caparzo? Where was compassion for these guys? We love these guys. And even Ryan says it towards the end. He's like, these other guys fought just as hard as I did. Yeah. Why don't they get to go home? It's such a great notion, but it's great to see because they're on a mission of compassion in the midst of a horrible situation. They get a different perspective on the war. They get a completely different perspective on the war. And that's what Mike says towards the end. I think you have that clip too. The sergeant does too, about this mission of compassion might be the only decent thing we do. And what if that's true? And I think that's important for our discussion about, okay, we're thrown in a war and we're in a battle with our brothers, but we can't forget compassion. Like in the midst of this, in the midst of the hard times, in the midst of feeling attacked, in the midst of trying to organize and pioneer a way off the beach to combat the chaos, we can't forget that without compassion, we won't do anything decent. Without mercy, without compassion, without seeing the humanity of people, and that there's something, there's home, right? They keep talking about home, right? You know, like yeah. You can easily kind of get distracted from what's really important. And so that's something that kind of keeps popping up, and they argue about it, right? In the movie, they're not giving speeches really until later about it, but they're arguing about it. And right. They're complaining about it.
Right. They hate Ryan, and they've never met him. You know, there's two things there. One is if you apply what we've been saying, what we see in this movie, the battle is brutal. And you see it, right? I mean, we're coming off a year and a half of COVID with the quarantines and political and racial stress, and you know, that's just this year. That's not the stuff that's going on, the child slavery or the sex trafficking or the take your pick. Look in any one of these countries in strife and you sort of wonder, because that's like you said earlier, where's God in this? And well, yeah, because we live in a world at war.
Yeah.
Hello. But in this world of war, it's very easy to lose our heart and to lose who we are, lose our humanity, because we're also, as children of God, on a mission of compassion.
That's
to
right.
Engage with the hearts of those around us, to pursue the hearts of those around us. And part of that starts with protecting our own. What you were saying segued great for this next scene. They have that scene in the church, and then they keep going, and then Captain Miller has a tough call, because they come to a place. He's like, there's a machine gun nest up there. And his guys, they're like, screw them. That's not our mission. That's not our small story, little picture mission. But Captain Miller says, no, our big mission is to win the war. And if we just ignore this machine gun nest, somebody else will walk into it and somebody else will have to deal with it. And we're here now. We can take this on. This is within our scope. That's the right thing to do. Well, as part of that, one of their guys dies. Their medic, Wade, played by Giovanni Ribisi. Again, cast of just excellent actors. And so they get mad, and they're going to kill the German who they took prisoner, who surrendered. But Upham says, no, this is wrong. Captain Miller ends up letting the German go. And this really makes Ed Burns, and I can't remember his character's name, but he gets super, super pissed off. He's like, I'm leaving. I'm screw Ryan. I'm out of here, defying a direct order.
Well, this is a failure of leadership for Miller. This is a crucible moment of leadership. And the sergeant is about to shoot, you know, Edward Burns in the face, and you know, all the, you know, this, it's like getting really intense. And it's so well written that this is how he redeems the moment.
Captain just gave you an order.
Yeah. Like the one he gave to take this machine gun. That was a real doozy, wasn't it, Sarge?
Soldier, you are way out of line.
Yes, sir. That was one hell of a call coming to take this nest, but the hell, we only lost one of our guys going for it. I swear, I hope Mama Ryan's real fucking happy knowing that little Jimmy's life is a little bit more important than two of our guys. But then again, we haven't found them yet, have we? Have we?
Here you go. Get the hell off me.
Riven, get up. Gear up. Fall in.
I'm done with this mission.
Hey! Hey!
sir.
Don't you walk away from your captain. Riven, get back in line.
No, sir. I'll spend the rest of my life in the stockade if I have to, but I'm done with this.
I'm not gonna ask you again, soldier.
Captain!
This is bullshit.
Fall in.
You gonna shoot me over Ryan?
No, I'm gonna shoot you because I don't like you.
Sir, listen, I
got if he wants to go, just let him go.
You gonna shoot me?
Are you letting this happen? Why don't you put one? Captain, you see this?
Captain.
Sir.
Sir, Ryan's dead.
Bullshit.
So we have a situation.
Bullshit.
Get in on.
Captain, I have a sixth sense about these things. I know it in my bones.
You don't kill that son of a bitch, Crab. Now you're gonna shoot me.
Huh? He's better than you.
Then why don't you just do it, Sarge?
Do it, man. Put one in my leg and give me that $1 million.
I'm gonna shoot you in your big goddamn mouth.
Well, put your money where your mouth is and do it then.
Shut
do
up,
it.
You don't know
pull
how
the trigger
to
already!
Up.
Captain, please!
Give me that.
What's the pool on me up here?
Oh, I'll do it, I will do it! Robin! You are a coward, son of a bitch!
I'm waiting, son.
What's
waiting. The pool on me up to right now? What's it up to? What is it, $300, is that it? $300? I'm a school teacher. I teach English composition in this little town called Adley, Pennsylvania. In the last 11 years, I've been at Thomas Alva Edison High School. I was a coach of the baseball team in the springtime.
Be doggone.
Back home, and I tell people what I do for a living, and they think, well, now that figures. But over here, it's a big mystery. So I guess I've changed some. Sometimes I wonder if I've changed so much my wife is even going to recognize me whenever it is I get back to her. And how I'll ever be able to tell her about days like today. Ryan. I don't know anything about Ryan. I don't care. Man means nothing to me. It's just a name. But if, you know, if going to Rommel and finding him so he can go home, if that earns me the right to get back to my wife, well, then that's my mission. You want to leave? You want to go off and fight the war? All right. All right, I won't stop you. I'll even put in the paperwork. I just know that every man I kill, the farther away from home I feel.
And the whole purpose of that big, long clip was basically for that last line. With every man I kill, the farther from home I feel. As we talk about both the battle and compassion, that we can wake up and say, how did I get here? You know, how can I tell? You know, he says, how would I tell my wife about a day like today? Would she even recognize who I am? And it's really easy to lose ourselves. I meet with a couple friends, and last night I asked them, I said, well, how wholehearted are you feeling these days? And one of them said, about 2.5 to 3 1/3. And you know, it's work and it's the kids and it's just all the pressure and the stress of life. And it's hard to, as we said earlier, to guard our hearts, to pursue our hearts, to protect our hearts, to find that compassion in the pursuit of the hearts of those around us. But it's by doing these little choices that might, you know, people saw him as a captain, as this mysterious person. You know, there was a big pool, $300 at stake, trying to figure out what he did. And he used that because he's like, I'm a person. I'm not some robot that came out of officer candidacy school. I'm a person. And I'm trying to keep my humanity as much as possible.
It's such an important scene. And again, it's such a great script. Every scene is important. I mean, that's why it is such a great script. It's 2 hours and 46 minutes long or something like that. But here's what he does. Here's how he diffuses a situation. And I've said this before. He asks a question. They're in the middle of this And he activates a different part of their brain by asking a question. How much is the pool up to by now? Like everyone is, they're so focused on this one thing. And in order to divert them, right, he asks a question. But he's not just asking any question. He's asking a question that's going to bring him to be the first one to be vulnerable. He chooses that time to give them something incredibly valuable, which is something vulnerable about himself. I was a teacher. This is who I am. And it totally diffuses the situation. And it's beautiful. It's a beautiful example of leadership, not management, leadership. Because here's what he does is he's vulnerable with them, and he tells them what's important. Going home is important. My wife is important. But there's certain value in that. It's not like they're completely removed. removed from real life. That they know what they're fighting for. They know why they're fighting. And so he's reminding them of that. And then he says, if you want to go, you can go. I'll let you go. So it reminded me of when Jesus says, eat my flesh, drink my blood. And he didn't even explain it to a culture of clean and unclean. And, you know, he didn't even explain it. He just said, if you don't eat and drink my, you know, eat my flesh, drink my blood, you can't have any part of me. And it says many left him that day, and he turns to his disciples and he says, are you going to leave me too? In other words, they were free to leave at any point. And this is what Miller does. He goes, I'll let you go. I'm going to keep going.
Yeah.
But if you want to go, I'll sign the papers. I'll do the paperwork or whatever. I'll let you go. I'm not going to shoot you. You get to go. But this is where I'm going. And then I don't know if you remember in the movie, but then his next act is to go and start dealing with the dead bodies of other soldiers, of their countrymen. And that pulls them to get back together. And what we see next after they find Ryan, there's a great little moment after they've prepared for the war where they're sitting there, and we can get to that in a second. But all of that, the only way that happens is if he does this. He asks questions. He's vulnerable. He admits his own failures. He admits who he is. Like, he doesn't put anything on them. It's all on him. And that's just great leadership. But so, this is like a seminar, like I told you before we recorded. This could be like a seminar on leadership, on great leadership. Like, you, if you screw up, take responsibility for it. Like, so many times as leaders, as men, and we're all leaders, men, women, we're all leaders somewhere. As leaders, when we screw up, what we want to do is stake our claim and fight to be right, right? Which was what Mike was doing, right? The captain gave you an order. Like, it's
right.
It's rule. It's law. It's the law. It's the Old Testament. You know, that's what we want to do. That's what we want to do in the church. But
to our kids.
To our kids. That's what we want to do in our business. I'm the dad. You have to respect me, you know. Respect my authority. What was that from South Park or something?
Cartman, yeah.
But what he does instead is he's vulnerable. And he makes it about what's important in life. And it's such a great model for leadership. Jesus would do the same thing. I'm going to die for you. Like when they're about to go, you can leave, but of course I love the response from the disciples when he says, there's a back door. You can leave. And they say, where else can we go? You have the words of life. Like, no, and we have to do that in Christianity. I'm not saying you get saved again. I'm saying in our walk in Christianity, you can say daily, Jesus says, take up your cross daily. Like, there are moments we have to make the decision again. And it feels like getting saved again. It's not getting saved again, but it feels like it, right? Because you're like, I got to come to this again in freedom and choice. Because that's intimacy and that's love and see the purpose and see what's going on. So that scene to me is so powerful. So
because there's times that we feel that way. We're like, I've had enough of this garbage. I'm out of here. I can't take it anymore. What was that? I think Dallas Willard said something about to have how we respond to Jesus disappointing us. And it tells a lot. I think it tells a lot about who we are and what our real values are. Because in this moment, Ryben was disappointed. He's like, you made this decision, and now one more of our guys are dead.
Right.
And oh, by the way, now two guys have died. Honestly, nothing to do with Ryan, right? Vin Diesel died because he was dumb and like took the kid from the people in the busted out house. And this was just something that happens when you, it wasn't Ryan's fault that they died. Right. And yet he's equating Ryan and his mother's happiness to the loss of their guys, which isn't a balance. But I think we feel that way sometimes when things don't work out the way we think they should, when things don't look like how we think they should. And we get to that, like you mentioned before, your friends who had been Christians and then had become atheists. Because it, like you said, Jesus says, do you want to go too? And some people do.
Some people do. And here's what is at the heart of a lot of these conversations that we get into. And I don't know if you've ever done this, but I've been in a situation, sometimes even petty situations, where it's not going the way I want. And I literally look at Jesus and I say, why are you doing this to me? I thought, I don't deserve this. I'm being good. Like he owes me.
Right.
Like he owes me something.
All my life I've strived for you.
All my life. And here's the thing, is that it's not about equaling the balance sheet with God. Because what he's going to end up giving me, I could never have earned. I could never have even come close to that on my own. In fact, I was going to lose everything I have anyway. But in the movie, they keep asking this question, and sometimes doing what's right is enough. It's not going to make up for Caparzo and Wade. It's not going to make up for his other three brothers dying. It's not going to make up. And that's something that kind of keeps coming up in the letter from Marshall and the letter from Abraham Lincoln. This isn't going to make up. There's nothing we can do that can actually make up. See, because a person's life is so valuable, it is of infinite value to God. That's its real value. He gave his, if you want to know the value of a life, he gave his son for it. That's what he did. That's the value to God. So losing a life, there is no way to make that up. Let alone 3 or 4, 94. Like, there's no math that makes this work, because it's all, we're dealing with infinites.
Right.
Okay. We're dealing with eternals. And
absolute zeros.
And zeros, right? And so
it's like binary code. It's all ones and zeros.
But what God is asking us to do is say, be kind, right? Be kind, be merciful. Well, they don't deserve it. You're right. They don't. Be merciful. Be compassionate. This is how you're going to be like your father. This is how it's going to work. In the midst of a horrible, awful world where so many things happen and we don't understand them, and there's chaos around us all the time, God says, be compassionate. And sometimes doing what's right, it's not about balancing the sheet. It's not about making it fair. You can't do that. That's not about making it fair. It's about being like your father. And the reward, you can't lose that reward. And treating people like they have value. So they get finally to find Ryan. And then there's this amazing conversation where Ryan won't leave.
Our orders are to bring you back.
Bring me back.
Corporal Henderson, don't mean to leave you even more shorthanded, but orders are orders. Any communication when you're going to be relieved up here?
Sir, there's no way to tell. I mean, we have no idea what's happening south of us.
I have my orders too, sir. They don't include me abandoning my post.
I understand that, but this changes things.
I don't see that it does, sir.
The chief of staff for the United States Army says it does.
Sir, our orders are to hold this bridge at all costs. Now, our planes in the 82nd have taken out every bridge across the Murderette with the exception of two, one at Valone and this one here. We let the Germans take it, we're gonna lose our foothold and have to displace.
Private, your outfit wants to stay, that's one thing. But your party's over here.
Sir, I can't leave until at least reinforcements
get here. You got 3 minutes to gather your gear.
Sir, what about them? I mean, there's barely hardly enough of this.
Two of our guys already died trying to find you, all right?
What were their names?
Arwin Wade and Adrian Caparzo.
Wade and
Caparzo.
It doesn't make any sense, sir. Why? Why do I deserve to go? Why not any of these guys? They all fought just as hard as me.
Is that what they're supposed to tell your mother? When they send her another folded American flag?
Tell her that when you found me, I was here, and I was with the only brothers that I have left. And there's no way I was gonna desert them. I think she'll understand that. There's no way I'm leaving this bridge.
What I love about that scene is the writers made Ryan somebody worth saving. Like, they actually, again, it's not about, you know, we can never be good enough to be saved. And right. I get that. Like, I get the theology of it. But for us as people, the writers had to give us something about Ryan that makes him worth all that happened, all the sacrifice, all that's going to end up happening. And that's one of the themes of the movie. And so the fact that he sees himself as equal, he sees all these other guys' sacrifices in their fight. I know you said you've talked to men who have been through war and are veterans. And one of the things they deal with is this confusing and unanswerable question: why did I survive? Like, right. I didn't do anything. I wasn't better than them. What did the guy in the Band of Brothers say? You know, I wasn't a hero, but I served with them. You know, I can't think that I deserved anything. I don't deserve this. And the fact that he knows he doesn't deserve saving makes us love him as people. That makes us go, okay, that's a guy. That actually makes him worth saving. It gives us that tension that we need as to watch it and really care about the battle that's coming up. But I mean, I love that. The fact that he has new brothers, that goes in like that other theme about in the trenches, I have new brothers. Tell my mom I'm with my new brothers. Yeah. And he still grieves his old brothers. It doesn't mean he didn't care about his biological brothers. He, you know, he tells a story and all that. We can get to that in a second, but it just means that he has new brothers and that he's not going to leave them either. You think my old brothers were important? These brothers are just as important.
Yeah. And it leads to our next clip, because Captain Miller goes off and talks with his sergeant, Mike, because now they, like Shrek did with the princess, do you throw Ryan over your shoulder and walk off with him? Or what do? Do you leave him and then sort of not fulfill your mission? What do you do? And that's one of those crossroads that I think a lot of us face when we get to a decision like this, where, wait, I was coming here for this to happen. Their whole mission was, we're going to get Ryan, get him out of here. Now he doesn't want to go. He makes a valid point. And now what do we do?
Part of me thinks the kid's right. What's he done to deserve this? He wants to stay here, fine. Let's leave him and go home.
Yeah.
But another part of me thinks, what if by some miracle we stay and actually make it out of here? Someday we might look back on this and decide that saving Private Ryan was the one decent thing we were able to pull out of this whole god-awful shitty mess. That's what I was thinking, sir. Like you said, Captain, we do that, we all earn the right to go home.
Which is kind of interesting, because both of them will end up dying in the firefight, and in a sense, they will go home.
Mm-hmm. Well, but they acted like home was real.
Yeah.
That's what's important, is they acted as if home was real. They wouldn't just randomly kill people at home. Like, if they got into a fight at home, like, these are not men who would go out and start shooting their neighbors if they didn't like them, right? I mean, like, these were good, decent men, as far as we know, right? I mean, that's kind of the whole point, is I was a teacher and I, you know, coached baseball or all that stuff. Like, these are good, decent men. And again, it comes back to doing a decent thing, even if I get nothing out of it, is the most God-honoring thing I can do. That's the bravest thing I can do, is doing the one decent thing that I can think of.
And it goes back to being able to see the bigger picture versus the smaller picture, living in the larger story. The larger story was winning the war. And they knew, and in a previous conversation, Captain Miller knew the strategy that it would take to win, to take Berlin. You know, we take this place, we take this place.
Yeah, so he knew setup.
The importance of maintaining, of controlling that bridge.
Yep.
And the only reason that he and his, I guess, six other guys now were there was because they were looking for Ryan. Well, their presence also, it looks like, about doubled the force holding the bridge. There weren't a lot of guys there. And so that's sort of what Sergeant Mike there says. He's got a point. We could leave him here. But what if by being here, we do something greater than we thought we could do? It's not about one man. But he said, what if this is the best thing we can do in this whole shitty war? We stood up when we needed to. We took a stand. We didn't take the easy way out. Again, going back to that theme, that's where brotherhood is made. It'd be easy to tap out. It'd be easy to say, no, I'm not going to call that guy. He's kind of a jerk and I'm tired of hanging out with him. Or, you know, it'd be easy to, it's always easier to not do something. It's always easier to check out. And they said, what if we take the harder path? That's the right thing that will get us one step closer to home.
Yeah. What's the right thing? What's the truth? What's the right? And that's why asking that question is so important. What's true? And I have to act based on what's true. And I'm just going to say this really quickly, but the reason why this movie is so important is, and we've already said it, we're in a war. And there may come a day in America where acting according to the truth has some serious consequences. There are places all around the world right now where acting according to the truth can come
with
serious.
We'll get you killed.
We'll get your family killed or raped or whatever. Just standing up for truth. Just declaring truth.
Just owning a Bible.
Just owning. like this is doing what is true. Acting according to what is truth is a powerful thing, but in some cases, it can be a very dangerous thing. And so the reason why we have to keep talking about this is because a lot of Americans think that if God loves us, then he'll get us out of it. But I'm telling you, there are Christians all over the world right now where that's not true. He doesn't get them out of the bad situation. One of my favorite memes recently, and I'm going to mess up quoting it, but where it says, I would have pulled Joseph out of the pit. I would have kept David from being exiled and living in caves. Compassion would make me say, no, I would have kept Jesus from dying on the cross. I wouldn't have wanted him to go through that. Like we have this idea, but if that doesn't happen, we don't get the good stuff. Like, we don't get the victory if we had pulled Joseph out of the pit, he wouldn't have saved Egypt, right? I mean, there are consequences down the road. And so living by the truth is going to have more eternal and weighty and real and lasting impact later. But it's hard in the moment, and it doesn't always, and it's not going to seem fair. I guarantee it's not going to seem fair. It's not fair that these guys went to go save Ryan and they all died. I mean, it's not fair that Captain, you know, Miller dies at the end. He doesn't get to go home to his wife. But again, Captain Miller has to make a choice, and he makes a choice consistently based on the good of everyone. Right. And that's what Ryan reminds him of. Like, if we don't hold this bridge, then it's not just about me. It's not just about my friends. Like, if we don't hold this bridge, like, we can lose the war. Like you said, it was a great setup that they kind of pulled that in earlier in the movie. And they just made it a part of dialogue as if like they were complaining about the British general, which they probably did complain about the British general, all that to say. But so then they organize and they get ready. And even Ryan and Miller have an exchange of storytelling. And one of my favorite lines is when Ryan says, you know, tell me more about your wife and those rose bushels. And he goes, I'm saving that one. Like, that one, that's only for me. But anyway, that's such a great moment in the movie for me, is that we need to give ourselves space for those times in church where we tell each other stories, where we share who we are, because that's part of being in a battle together. It's not just about a Bible study. I mean, yes, we need to study the Bible, but they shared gum, and they, you know, they, what's mine is yours. And you know, they put all their resources together and different units and people from different, right? I loved how they would introduce themselves, because it is true during D-Day that the airborne Rangers were scattered. Like, none of them landed where they were supposed to land. And if they hadn't been trained a certain way, they would not have won. And how they were trained, if you don't know, historically, is every man knew the whole plan of D-Day. They knew where they memorized the map, and they had been trained that the highest ranking officer is the one in charge. So if you happen to, you know, thunder and lightning or whatever, what was it? Thunder and flash and thunder, right? They had a system worked out where they could recognize each other. And even if they had people from different companies and battalions or whatever, you know, all the different things, like, they could say, okay, well, who's the highest ranking officer, right? And that guy's in charge. And that's why Captain Miller is in charge on the beach, because he's like, who's in charge? You know. And then in the final battle, he's the highest ranking officer, so he gets to make these choices. And so all of this stuff is so great to me about just learning what's important and empowering people. So often in leadership and management, like I said, it's more management that we try to hold information back from people. And it's like, no, like, literally, a private would know almost as much about the plan for D-Day as the general did. Like, that's so awesome to me. That's so about equality and empowerment. And that's what you see.
So we approach the end of the movie. Captain Miller had been shot. So Ryan comes up, and the powerful moment where Miller tells Ryan, he says, earn this. And then we're going to flash in this clip. We're going to flash back to the old guy, old Ryan, at the graveside of Captain Miller, where he's questioning whether or not he did.
James, earn this.
To be honest with you, I wasn't sure how I'd feel coming back here. Every day, I think about what you said to me that day on the bridge. I've tried to live my life the best I could. I hope that was enough. I hope that at least in your eyes, I've earned what all of you have done for me. Tell me I've led a good life.
What?
Tell me I'm a good man.
And I think we get invited into the same thing. It's not a earn your salvation or earn redemption or earn heaven or whatever it is you want to throw in there. But it's a recognition of the sacrifice. because Jesus loved us so much. And what is our response? We're not trying to earn it because it's already been achieved. Ryan wasn't trying to earn his salvation, his rescue, because it had already been done. And yet we all have that question. Tell me I've lived a good life. Tell me I'm a good man. And he asks his wife, as Britt says, that's the one, the person who knows best, you know, of can evaluate you the best. And, but it's living life. He says, I've lived that every day. I've remembered that every day. And if we can look, we're our response, our decisions, you know, all these little decisions to remember home, to maintain our humanity. You mentioned communion. Do this in remembrance of me. And if we remember Jesus and we remember the price that was paid, not because we're worthless, but because we're worth so much to him. What would he do to rescue us, to send in for the one lost sheep?
Mm-hmm.
He sent himself. Jesus, in this case, is the rescue team. And he did come to rescue us, so that we could become part of the kingdom, so that we could take up arms and fight and be a part of the battle of compassion.
Yeah.
To win the world.
And I love about that last scene with Miller is he doesn't call him Ryan. All throughout the movie, he's been calling him Ryan, Private Ryan, James Francis. But it's Saving Private Ryan. But here he calls him James. He calls him by, it's a very intimate thing to me. And it's a fatherly sort of moment. Like he's almost like a father to a son, like a mentor to, like, and that's why we have that great scene. That's why we needed that scene when they tell their stories and he talks about his brothers in the barn and almost burning the barn. Like they have this great intimate moment where they connect. That's why that's important, because now he can give him that. He commissions him. Just like Jesus commissions the disciples, he doesn't say, okay, it's great that you're no longer in hell, or you're no longer going to hell, so just kind of hang out and chill for a while. Like, he says, no, you go out and teach what I taught. This is your job now. This is, if you're going to be like me, I discipled you, I saved you, I filled you with my spirit. All of that stuff had a purpose, and that was so you would be the rescuer. You are rescued to be a rescuer. That's why this happened. And that's why that last moment always makes me cry, where he looks to somebody and says, tell me I've done that. Tell me I've had this sort of impact. Who cares? Even if it's just one, like, did I pass something on that's real? Did I leave a legacy, a faith of something that's real? And it's such an important part of the movie. Not that he earned it, although that's the way it's
said.
Those are the words. But he fulfills his commission. He was commissioned by Miller.
Well, it's about living a life worthy of the call.
Yeah, that's good. Yeah, which is actually words in the Bible.
Right. I didn't make that up.
You didn't make that up. But here's the thing. This is what I said the other day at church. I said, look, here's the reality. You want to know reality? The same spirit that said, let there be light, and light happened, lives in you. That's reality. Now, I'm not saying I understand what that means. I'm just saying we have to understand what's happening here. This isn't just, again, to save us from hell. That is important. And God doesn't want us to go to hell. It makes him sad when people die and the destruction, and like it he weeps over that stuff. Over death and the destruction of sin and the enemy and all of that stuff. He weeps over that stuff, but what he's after is life, and a life of purpose, a life of truth, a life of reality. And we as Christians have to start empowering each other with this. We have to commission one another. Like you said, are you living wholehearted? Are you living up to what your calling is? And not in a put you down sort of way, but in a, how can I help you do that? Yeah. How can I encourage you to do that? How can I give you resources to that? How can I do that? That's what discipleship is.
Because I think we all get pinned down on the beach sometimes, and we all got to say, hey, we got to get out of here, man. You're dying, but we got to keep pushing forward.
Yeah.
You can't stay here.
If you stay here, you die. So what a great movie. And I think what a great message about brotherhood, about how we get real brotherhood. I think we all long for it, but this is how we get it, about leadership and about what it means to live in truth and what's real. So I think it's great.
So this has been Paul McDonald and Britt Mooney talking about Saving Private Ryan. Check us out on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, Google Play, or our website, menatthemovies.com/podcast, where we've got resources, questions, quotes, themes. We don't have any games. Sorry. No fun in games.
We could.
We need an app developer or something.
Well, we're going to put those on Patreon.
Yeah, there you go. And if you really like us, visit our website on patreon.com/menatthemovies to be an investor and help support our ministry, our mission, and some of the cool stuff that we're going to be doing here in the next several months. Hope you join us next time here on the Men at the Movies podcast.
Something inside has been awakened. I can no longer be who I was before. But if I am no longer who I was, who am I to be?